risen. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, who in the Paschal mystery established the new covenant of reconciliation, grant that all who have been reborn into the fellowship of Christ's body may show forth in their lives what they profess by their faith. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them. You that are Israelites, listen to what I have to say. Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with deeds of power, wonders, and signs that God did among you, as you yourselves know. This man handed over to you according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God. You crucified and killed by the hands of those outside the law. But God raised him up, having freed him from death, because it was impossible for him to be held in its power. For David says concerning him, I saw the Lord always before me, for he is at my right hand so that I will not be shaken. Therefore, my heart was glad, and my tongue rejoiced. Moreover, my flesh will live in hope. For you will not abandon my soul to Hades or let your Holy One experience corruption. You have made known to me the ways of life. You will make me full of gladness with your presence. Fellow Israelites, I may say to you confidently of our ancestor David, that he both died and was buried, and his tomb is with us to this day. Since he was a prophet, he knew that God had sworn an oath to him that he would put one of his descendants on his throne. Foreseeing this, David spoke of the resurrection of the Messiah, saying, "He was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh experience corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all of us are witnesses." The word of the Lord.
Thank you. A reading from the first letter of Peter. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith, for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time. In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him. And even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. The word of the Lord.
Evening of the day of resurrection, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the people. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do you not doubt, but believe?" Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord.
Send your Spirit, God, to open our hearts and our minds to your word and strengthen us to live according to your will, in Jesus' name. If you have ever lived in a clergy household, you know that while Easter is a joyous festival for everyone, for those of us who work in churches, it is also exhausting. Now, don't get me wrong. We love Holy Week. We love Easter. We love all the special services we hold. But they do take it out of one. After last Sunday's Evensong, someone came up to me and said, "Christ is risen." And I said, "I know. I saw it happen 4 times. When the final service of Easter or Christmas is over, the cleric slinks home and begins to unwind. Various clergy do this differently, but last Sunday, I decided, rather unwisely, I think, that I would decompress by starting to watch the HBO series Game of Thrones from the beginning. My son Oliver, whose tastes are remarkably similar to mine and therefore highly sophisticated, had told me recently that he had begun watching the series and that he really loved it. So on that recommendation, I came home last Sunday and I watched season 1, Episode 1 of Game of Thrones on demand. I gave up after 15 minutes. Who were all these people? There were Starks, there were Lannisters, there were Targaryens, and then there were the barbaric Dothraki speaking some sort of weirdo made-up language. It kind of looked like medieval England, and it kind of looked like the Old West. And my wife, Kathy, kept walking through the room saying, how can you stand to watch this made-up mythological stuff? I was too tired and I was too confused to make sense of this story and its characters, and so I gave up. But that night I talked to my son Oliver on the phone in California, and I told him of my disappointment. And he said that I needed to give Game of Thrones at least 3 episodes. So after a night's sleep, I gave it a second try. While my adorable but skeptical wife was out of the house, I watched the first 3 episodes back to back. I am now hooked. I am a full-blown Game of Thrones junkie. The world is watching season 4, but I am galloping through season 1. I am late to the party, but I still consider myself a member of the family. So look for me soon to be wearing all the requisite Game of Thrones insignia wear around the cathedral. I'm trying as well as I can to catch up with a story where I'm still way behind. In that respect, I am just like Thomas in this morning's gospel. Now, according to John's account, Thomas was not with the disciples when Jesus first appeared to them as a group. Everyone else has had an experience that Thomas is not in on. Like a latecomer to an episodic TV series, Thomas needs to catch up rather quickly. In his most oft-quoted remark, he says, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in my hand in his side, I will not believe." If we want to understand Thomas, we need to hear both what he is and what he is not saying. Enlightenment rationalism, 19th century empiricism, and 20th century existentialism have given rise to many attempts to claim Thomas as the first skeptic. I have heard many sermons over the years that make Thomas an intellectual hero, and which treat this story as a parable of faith and doubt. As important as those concerns are, they are not central to the story on its own terms. Thomas is not so much a hero as he is simply a latecomer. He wants to be brought up to speed. Touching Jesus is the quickest way to do that. His request to examine Jesus' wounds as proof is exactly like binge-watching Game of Thrones. So listen again to what Jesus and Thomas actually say to each other in this passage. Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." And Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Thomas is trying to understand whether the person before him is or is not Jesus. When he wants to know if the man claiming to be Jesus is real, he asks to see the mark of the nails in his hands and the wounds in his side. And when Jesus wants to prove that he is who he says he is, he points Thomas's hands to the place where he has suffered. What we often miss when we hear this story is the connection between Jesus's credibility and his wounds. Now, one of the reasons why Christians have always treated Holy Week from Palm Sunday to Maundy Thursday to Good Friday and Easter as a whole is that the resurrection of Jesus makes no sense if it is not grounded in the reality of his suffering and death. Without Good Friday, Easter is merely a sentimental celebration of spring. And as wonderful as spring is, hey, I like spring, especially after this last winter, spring cannot contain the fullness of the meaning of Easter. Spring is lovely, but spring is nothing compared to the resurrection. So Jesus' wounds in this story are not some kind of parlor trick. They are central to who Jesus is. The whole drama of God being involved in human life and in human experience, and especially in human suffering, that whole drama is represented by the wounds in Jesus' hands and in his side. Those nail and spear marks remind us, as nothing else can, of the extent to which God is willing to go to love and bless and heal us. Like Thomas, we know who God is by tracing the wound marks in the flesh of Jesus. The encounter with us at the cross has cost God something. Yet even still, Jesus comes among us and proclaims, "Peace be with you." Our relentless focus on the "I won't believe it unless I see it" aspect of this account has obscured for some of us the story's bigger truths. So listen again to how this passage starts. "When it was evening on the day of resurrection, the first day of the week, Jesus came and stood among them and said, 'Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you.' When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, 'Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained.'" Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. "As the Father has sent me, so I send you. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven." This is not so much a story about faith and doubt as it is about woundedness and mission. The risen and wounded Jesus sends his companions out to spread the news. We know who he is because his wounds establish his identity. And it is precisely because he is wounded that he can send his friends out on a mission of peace and forgiveness. "Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven." Just as you and I can miss what this story is about, so we can forget what Easter itself is about or what the church is actually here for. Easter is about the triumph of God's suffering wounded love over human enmity and hate. It is about the ultimate victory of empathy over power, of community over empire. God comes into human history not as Caesar, but as a Palestinian Jewish peasant. God engages with human beings not as subjects, but as companions. And in response, people take Jesus to the cross. And in dying on the cross, Jesus experiences the depths of suffering that each and all of us can know. Physical pain, persecution, oppression, grief, and loss, they are all there in those 3 hours on Calvary. And then 1 week after Easter, Jesus comes among his companions and wishes them peace, sends them out in love, and gives them the authority to forgive each other and the world. 1 week after Easter, Jesus comes among us and wishes us peace and sends us out in love and gives us the authority to forgive each other and the world. All of us have suffered, and each of us is offered a choice this day. We can dwell self-protectively in isolation, or we can allow our wounds to open us up to the suffering of others. If we do the first, we will perpetuate the cycle of retribution and violence. Welcome to Game of Thrones. If we do the second, we together will heal and bless the world. Welcome to the gospel. So let us use this day and this hour to remember what Easter is finally about. You are wounded. I am wounded. So are those who have injured us. They too are wounded. Remember who Jesus is. Remember what Jesus suffered. And remember what Jesus says to us this morning. He says, "Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. As the Father has sent me, so I send you. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven." You and I have been given authority by Jesus to let go of our own wounds and to extend forgiveness to others. As Easter's greatest and ultimate gift, let us take that wounded authority and use it to spread peace and forgiveness both as near and as far as we can. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshiped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Life-giving God, you strengthen the faith of the believing and quicken the hope of the doubting through the resurrection of Jesus, your Son. He comes giving peace, breathing spirit, calling forth Easter joy. Alive in Christ and filled with his Spirit, we pray for the church, for the world, and for all you have made. Jesus, light of the world, bring the light and peace of your gospel to the nations. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us and accept your prayers. Jesus, bread of life, give food to the hungry and nourish us all with your word. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us and accept your prayers. Jesus, our way, our truth, our life, be with us and all who follow you in the way. Deepen our appreciation of your truth and fill us with your life. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us and accept your prayers. Jesus, Good Shepherd, who gave your life for the sheep, recover the strangler, bind up the injured, strengthen the sick, and lead the healthy and strong to new pastures. Jesus, Lord of life, in your mercy, hear us and accept your prayers. Jesus, the resurrection and the life, we give you thanks for all who have lived and believed in you. Raise us with them to eternal life. Jesus, Lord of life.
Risen Christ, enter our hearts this day, overcoming every barrier we create to your presence. Breathe life and hope into every room of doubt and despair. Awaken faith amid our fear. Lead us to proclaim the promise of Easter. This Jesus God raised up, in his presence there is fullness of joy. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Amen. In baptism we died with Christ, so that as Christ was raised from the dead, we might walk in newness of life. Let us receive new life in him as we confess our sins in penitence and faith. Jesus Christ, risen Master and triumphant Lord, we come to you in sorrow for our sins and confess to you our weakness and our unbelief. We have lived by our own strength and not by the power of your resurrection. We have lived by the light of our own eyes as faithless and not believing. We have lived for this world alone and doubted our home in heaven. In your mercy, forgive us. Lord, hear us and help us. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, and strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen. The risen Christ came and stood among his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." Then they were glad when they saw the Lord. Alleluia. The peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome again to the Cathedral. Please be seated for a couple of announcements. Everyone here is welcome at God's table, whoever you are and wherever you find yourself on the journey of faith. You are welcome to receive the bread and wine of communion. There are ushers who will direct you to the communion station. If you would rather receive a blessing than take communion, please signal that to us by folding your arms across your chest, and we'll know that that is your preference. After you've come forward to the communion, you are invited to proceed to the south side of the nave to War Memorial Chapel, where our healing ministers are gathered to pray with you, to give you the laying on of hands for healing and to pray with you for your own needs and concerns, the needs and concerns of those you love, the needs and concerns of our nation and the world. Afterwards, on the west side of the nave, we have coffee and all are invited to that. We are not just a building, we are also an institution that engages faith and public life and has a worshiping community at the heart of it. So if you'd like to learn more about becoming a member of our congregation, please go to the congregation table back by the coffee hour and you will find information on how to do that. We have three groups visiting us this morning. The Veritas School from Oregon, are you guys here? Welcome. Notice I pronounced the name of your state correctly. Christ Memorial Episcopal Church from Pennsylvania, where are you guys? Welcome. And Middletown United Methodist Church from Maryland. Welcome to you. So on behalf of the Cathedral community, welcome to all of you today. God has been generous to all of us in so many ways, and we respond now to God's generosity by giving to support the mission and the ministry that this cathedral church and the church itself does in God's name. So let us with gladness present the offerings and the oblation of our life and our labor to God.
Oh,
be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. But chiefly are we bound to praise you for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. For he is the true Paschal Lamb who was sacrificed for us and has taken away the sin of the world. By his death, he has destroyed death, and by his rising to life again, he has won for us everlasting life. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. We give thanks to you, O God, for the goodness and love which you have made known to us in creation, in the calling of Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all, in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night before he died for us, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, according to his command, O God, we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory, and we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, O Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we may be acceptable through him, being sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ, and bring us to that heavenly country wherewith Mary, the mother of Jesus, Peter and Paul and all your saints, we may enter the everlasting heritage of your sons and daughters. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church, and the author of our salvation. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. As we join our prayers with those of the Church Universal, so we say each in our own language the prayer that Jesus has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ. Let us pray. God of all, we give you thanks and praise that when we were still far off, you met us in your Son and brought us home. Dying and living, he declared your love, gave us grace, and opened the gate of glory. May we who share Christ's body live his risen life. We who drink his cup bring life to others. We whom the Spirit lights give light to the world. Keep us firm in the hope you have set before us, so we and all your children shall be free, and the whole earth live to praise your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. May Christ, who out of defeat brings new hope and a new future, fill you with his new life. And may the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you on this day and remain with you always. Amen.
Let us go forth into the world, rejoicing in the power of the Spirit. Alleluia. Alleluia.